Welcome to the Late Night Late Night Show. And now your host, Cuddy Beano.
All right. Welcome to the Late Night Late Night Show. This is episode 35, I believe. And we've been gone a while. How long has it been? Like a month? I took like a month-long break. All I gotta say is burnout is real, people. Burnout is real. I was taking on too much over the past month. Live streaming twice a week and on top of my other responsibilities. So I think it just got to me. So I had to take a much needed vacation, which is weird because I just came back from vacation, but I needed a real vacation. You know what I mean? Like, there's traveling and then there's like resting. So I just needed to rest. Looks like we're back. We're back to our regularly scheduled program. I'm looking at the chat right now and I don't see anyone. And I don't expect to get any chatters today because every single time I take a break, my chatters just disappear. Carol with a K, I don't know where you are, but you're nowhere to be seen. Hyper Shadow, you're not here, but it's fine. Actually, I feel a little sick. I think I might have caught something on vacation, but other than that, I feel pretty good. We have a lot of stories to get through today, so let's go ahead and get started. All right, our first story. The rapper Waka Flocka Flame performs at a Pokemon trading card game convention. You heard that right. The rapper Waka Flocka Flame, the mastermind behind Grove Street Party and Hard in the Paint and what else? What his whole Flockavelli album is a classic to me. But yeah, he's performing at a Pokemon convention. Apparently, Waka is a secret Pokemon fan. Like, I saw an interview he did where he was talking about how he, like, loved Pokemon Go back when, like, Pokemon Go was a big craze. But, yeah, let's go ahead and look at this footage.
If it wasn't for this goat right here, come over here, man. Come over here, man. If it wasn't for this goat right here, man, we probably never know what Pokemon was in America, man. Thank God right now. Give a round of applause for this, man.
I like how he says Pokemon the same way like my mom says Pokemon, like Pokemon, like it's pronounced Pokemon, Waka. You should know this.
Let's celebrate. It's a party, man.
Okay, I'm not gonna lie, like, why did they get Waka Flocka to perform at this event? Like, I feel like at a Pokemon trading card game convention, there's gonna be a lot of kids, right? Like, I see a kid right here on this pause screen, like right in front of this phone. Like, so Waka's lyrics are not very kid friendly at all. He's dropping the F bomb. He's dropping like the N word. Like, just, what is Waka doing? Like, it's fine if he likes Pokemon, but why is he performing in front of a bunch of kids? Like, I don't know if I feel comfortable with this.
I see you on the left side. I see you on the right side. That's all. I got a whole lot of money. Bitch is counting for me. Why don't you keep coming? One, two, three, go. It's a party. It's a party.
Come on. once again, keep in mind, this is a Pokemon convention. This isn't some, which I guess makes sense. Like, what kind of rapper performs in, like, this kind of lighting? Like, normally you would be performing at, like, a club or a venue of some sort. But this is, like, a convention in the middle of the day. Like, fluorescent lighting. Like, what is going on here? And, yeah, that was the footage. It looks like, looking at this chat, we have no chatters, but like I said, that's to be expected. So we'll go on and get started with our second story then. All right, story number two. This should be pretty interesting. Oh, this is a big story, people. The band Linkin Park reveals new lead singer, Emily Armstrong. All right, so this was a pretty controversial topic this week. So as you guys know, the lead singer of the band Linkin Park, what was his name? Chester Bennington, passed away a few years ago. So the band hasn't really been performing since then. I don't think, at least. But it looks like they have a replacement singer, because you can't really replace Chester, but they have a new lead singer that will be performing Chester's parts at their concerts. But yeah, let's go ahead and check this out. All right, Billboard, meet the new Linkin Park. So there's a lot of controversy with this girl, because apparently, for one, she's a Scientologist, and yeah, I don't know how comfortable people are with, like, a person being a Scientologist in a band. Like, are they gonna, like, I guess it doesn't really matter, but if they're gonna have, like, Scientologists recruiting people at the concerts, that could be a problem. So I can understand the worry there, but I mean, people are free to believe whatever they want. I think the other issue was her supporting Danny Masterson, who was the actor from That 70s Show, who, like, I don't remember the details, but I know he was in court and got found guilty for abusing women. And I think maybe grape was involved, but I can't remember. But yeah, let's go ahead and just check out this concert footage. Okay, so this is footage from a performance they did where they unveiled the lead singer. And let's go ahead and see how she sounds. I'm not going to lie, I like it. Hopefully we don't get copyright, we don't get a copyright strike, but she has, like, that same, I don't know the word, like, gravel to her voice that, like, Chester had. And yet she sounds like very similar to him, but at the same time, she sounds different. Like, you know what she sounds like? She sounds like if you took Chester's voice and, like, put it through auto-tune, or not auto-tune, AI, and you told AI, hey, make this man's voice into a female voice. And, like, she sounds pretty identical to him, or at least identical to him on the CD. I'm not gonna lie, these songs are just, these are classics. These are, like, my childhood classics. These, Linkin Park came out when I was, like, in high school. So, like, these songs remind me of, like, a simpler time, like, my high school days. So, it does make me a little nostalgic. Shut up when I'm talking to you! Shut up! I'm actually very impressed. Like, she sounds, she actually sounds pretty amazing live. Every step that I take is another mistake to you. Like with me, I only really know the first three albums from Linkin Park. So like Hybrid Theory, Meteora, I think it was pronounced that. I forgot the name of the third album, but like I even liked the third album, which had like the song from Transformers. But then after that, I haven't paid attention to the band ever since. But yeah, this sounds pretty fire. Yeah, I have nothing negative to say about like her vocal ability. Like I think she kind of nails it. Like she sounds similar and yet different. And I even like her takes on those songs. But let's see, what does this say? This was written by Shinedown. The Brent Smith. I remember the very first time I heard Emily Armstrong from Dead Sarah. I guess that's her old band. Sing the Weatherman. I said to myself, I believe rock and roll will be okay. And so today I will say Linkin Park will be more than okay. I know the internet is still ablaze with comments of criticism and also of praise from fans all over the world. Something to think about. Do you honestly believe that members of this iconic band truly think that of all people, Chester is replaceable? The entire world knows he will never be replaceable because he was one of a kind. But with all that being said, there is an audience that missed this band and their presence and what they represent. So I ask you, all of you, give them the opportunity to not close their chapter. Allow them to celebrate their legacy and also the opportunity to create a new one. Give them hell. I agree with everything he said. I know Sublime's another one I can think of where the lead singer died and then they replaced him. Which the other thing is like these bands still need to like the members of the band still need to like make a living, you know? And like what do you expect to them never perform these songs again? Like this is just a part of life. Like you have to, you know, process the grief and then you gotta move on. I'm pretty sure Chester would be fine with this development. All right, so this right here, it's a message from Emily herself. I guess she saw the criticisms online about her supporting Danny. So let's see what she says. Hi, I'm Emily. I'm new to so many of you, and I wanted to clear the air about something that happened a while back. Several years ago, I was asked to support someone I considered a friend at a court appearance and went to one early hearing as an observer. Soon after, I realized I shouldn't have. I always try to see the good in people and I misjudged him. I have never spoken with him since. Unimaginable details emerged and he was later found guilty. To say it as clearly as possible, I do not condone abuse or violence against women and I empathize with the victims of these crimes. So, I kind of respect this. She's denouncing the man. Like, she doesn't want anything to do with him. She wants people to know where she stands. I'm glad she didn't, like, jump, like, you know, beat around the bush or dance around the subject. She just came out, made her statement as directly as possible. So, yeah, I respect this. All right, and then what does it say here? Linkin Park from Zero. New album out November 15. So, yeah, for any of you Linkin Park fans, you guys have a new album coming out. I will probably check it out. I know they just released their first single, and I still haven't had a chance to listen to it. But I'll give it a listen, and I'll get back to you guys about it. All right, and it looks like we still don't have any people in the chat, which is okay. We'll just move on to our third story then. All right, story number three. The new trailer for Dragon Ball Daima dropped. So yeah, we we here at Cuddy Bino Studios are big fans of Dragon Ball Z and Akira Toriyama. So this was the last show Akira Toriyama worked on before he passed away. So I definitely wanna react to this trailer. I haven't seen it yet, but I have seen the first trailer. So let's go ahead and cue the footage. Alright, so it looks like our editor forgot to put in subtitles for this trailer. So we're just going based off music and feeling. Did they change the animation? I could have sworn this was like, this was gonna be a computer generated show, like kind of like the last movie, what was the last movie? Man, I don't remember the name of the last movie, but you guys know the one I'm talking about, the one where like everything was it looked like a video game.
Dragon Ball.
Yeah, this looks like more traditional 2D. Maybe I'm wrong, but I could have swore the first trailer had these characters in 3D. So apparently the reason everyone's are kids is because if I'm remembering right from the first trailer, somebody makes a wish that everyone in the universe becomes kids or something. I don't remember the exact details, but yeah, this is what we're working with. I'm not gonna lie, that looks pretty interesting. I kind of wish. All right, hold on. All right, I kind of wish. I don't know. I kind of wish they went in a different direction with this show. I feel like having all the characters Goku and Vegeta be kids again is like it's a been there, done that. Like we had Dragon Ball GT people. We already had Goku as a kid. This is the one criticism I'll have is I feel like one of my favorite aspects of the original Dragon Ball and Dragon Ball Z was the fact that there was actually a passage of time. Like we saw Goku in like every stage of his life from a little kid in Dragon Ball to like, you know, becoming a father in Dragon Ball Z to even becoming a grandpa. So we've seen every stage of his life. And I feel like the passage of time is like a core part of Dragon Ball. Like I really like that, the fact that like you can't escape time. Like, you know, like like the one problem with cartoons nowadays, the characters never grow old. Like it's the reason we still have the Simpsons and South Park, and like these characters just aren't allowed to grow up. So like the one thing I liked about Dragon Ball is that's what made it different than other shows. It's like wow, we actually get to see these characters grow up. And now, like 30 years later, we're back to them being kids. So that's like my only criticism. But other than that, it looks great. All right. And looks like there's still nobody in the chat. All right, well, then we're going to go ahead and take a quick commercial break. And when we get back, we have 4 stories to get through, so it should be fun. So let's go ahead and cue the commercials.
Do you miss rewinding things like I do? The Sony Walkman, available in 1985.
So this is really who Donald Trump chose as his running mate?
I'm a never Trump guy.
I'm a never Trump guy.
I'm a never Trump guy.
I never liked him.
I'm a never Trump guy.
I'm a never Trump guy.
I'm a never Trump guy.
Never liked him.
I'm a never Trump guy.
Never.
I'm a never Trump guy.
Never.
I'm a never Trump guy.
Never.
I'm a never Trump guy.
Never liked him.
I'm just trying to take care of a kid. I've been in a trench getting rich. I don't know no way. That's my dog. Show my dog.
Arizona Iced Tea, the only inflation-proof juice on the market. Arizona Iced Tea Fruit Juice Cocktail, now in one fruit. Arizona Iced Tea, Bando loves it. Yo!
All right. And welcome back to the show. Like I said, it's been a whole month since I've done this. So I'm a little, what's the word? I don't want to say nervous. Like out of practice. It feels weird to be talking in the microphone again. But anyways, I don't see anyone in the chat. So we'll get started with our 4th story of the night. And this is a sad one. R.I.P. Fat Man Scoop and Rich Homie Quan. All right, I'm sad to say that both of these legends have passed away this week. Fat Man Scoop was only 56 years old, and Rich Homie Quan was 33, which is just so sad because Rich Homie Quan is actually younger than me, and I used to DJ back in the day, like weddings and parties and stuff, and like both of these guys' songs in the club used to just ring off, like especially a Type of Way by Rich Homie Quan. So this one really hurt. But yeah, let's go ahead and cue the story. All right, so just for context, this is so Fat Man Scoop passed away on stage, believe it or not. Fans were able to catch his final words, so let's go ahead and watch this.
Everybody jump when I say jump. Big strap, big strap. Oh, 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 oh. You got $100 bill. Put your hands up. You got a big
strap.
I said, can you make some noise? Yeah. Wait up. If you came to party, make some noise.
And that was the clip. He says, if you came to party, make some noise, and then he passes out, and then that's it. He's I don't know if he's pronounced dead here, but he's taken to the hospital, and then he's pronounced dead there. So it's just this is crazy. This is just unbelievable to me. Like I said, 56, so young. I don't know. Like, I don't think any details so far have been given as to what could have happened. This is just a message to my viewers. Like, keep up with your health, people. Keep up with your health. Like, health is wealth. There is nothing like money. Like, you can become as rich as possible, and you can't buy health. So remember that health is wealth. Like, these guys were very wealthy. I don't want to say rich, but these guys were wealthy, and it's just sad, man. It's just sad. And next up is Rich Homie Quan. So Rich Homie, I believe his girlfriend or his wife found him dead after taking their kid to school. So like, she believes he OD'd, and in this clip right here, he's gonna talk about his struggles with drug addiction. So let's go ahead and watch this. And trigger warning for those people that like are sensitive to this type of material.
Still booked every week though. Some mm-hmm. money ain't slowing down. $12,000, that's some good money still. Mm-hmm. It just ain't them 40s and them 50s I was getting.
Right.
But I'm still going to Dubai, you know what I mean? Dubai gonna give me more than that, so I'm doing Dubais and all that. But now me and Fly ain't talking because of the litigation, man. Fly not talking at all, you know what I'm saying? I can't drop no music, my show money down. Man, I got a dark cloud over my head, bro. Problems the person. I would definitely say I probably was the lowest I was in my life, because you got to think, man, I went from here to here fast. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And I blame myself. And it's growth. And I know it was my fault. Right. You know what I'm saying? Like, I might have said some shit 6 years ago in the interview, cussing nigga up. And I ain't that same corn no more, because, like, I've grown. So even if I did, I'd tell a nigga, man, don't fault me for that, bro. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I'm growing, man. You know what right. I'm saying? I didn't know, like.
Was it drugs involved?
Oh, hell yeah, man. I was on Molly every day.
Oof.
Listen, geeked up, spiked down. Listen, I'm talking, bro, I felt like I couldn't do a show or a song without being on Molly.
When did that start? When did the habit start?
When the habit started, shit. On the road, when I first got the road, I didn't.
I will say, as someone who's similar age to Rich Homie, like once you reach your 30s, you do grow up pretty fast. Like, I feel like, you know, all of my friends, like, we've all matured in our 30s. It's so weird. Like, in your 20s, you're like, it's like you don't think about the future, you're just living day to day. And then when you reach your 30s, at some point you get to a point where you start to just think about your life and your purpose and really like where you want to be and if you're happy where you are. And so I feel Rich Homie Quan here, and I also like understand like getting money fast and just not being able to mentally handle it. Like I understand that. Like I'm somebody that came from I don't want to say from nothing, but like my family, like I grew up in a mobile home, so my family struggled. You know, they made ends meet, but like we kind of struggled. And so like when I graduated college and started making like a salary, I know exactly what he's talking about. Like obviously it's not the same. It's not the same because he's probably, you know, if not a millionaire, close to a millionaire. And I'm nowhere near being a millionaire, but still I understand that feeling of like getting money and not really like being money smart, you know?
On the road, the $800 show, I ain't drank no liquor, no lean, no mm-hmm. none of that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Shit, before some type of way, we was doing so many shows, I couldn't stay up. Mm-hmm. So I knew some people like, bro, I got something to keep you up. That motherfucker kept me up. And, you know,
there's a machine after that.
If you don't mind, who said
that's where the babies is coming from.
If you don't mind, who said that to you? Who said they got something for you to keep you up? Was it somebody from the industry or one of your friends?
It's a family member.
Oh, family member.
Damn.
Yeah, and that was the clip. So as you heard, he struggled with mental health. He said he had a dark cloud over his head. And it looks like he was coping by using Molly and it sounds like even worse drugs than that. And that's very sad. I don't know what else to say. And both these guys are legends and like they definitely deserve our respect. And I can't believe that. Especially like if you're familiar with hip hop, you know what these guys contributed to it. Like Type of Way was so influential. Like I can't even begin to say it. So let's go ahead and check the chat real quick. All right, still empty. Well, we'll go ahead and move on to our fifth story of the night. All right, let's go ahead and lighten things up. The Weeknd. The Weeknd announces new album, which is titled Hurry Up Tomorrow. All right, so The Weeknd recently did a concert in Brazil where he previewed a lot of new music. He also previewed or released the title of the album, Hurry Up Tomorrow, and also the cover art, which is what we're looking at now. So, yeah, this is the cover art. This is supposed to be the third part of the trilogy of the first part was After Hours, the second one was Dawn FM, and now there's this one. So, I'm excited. All right, what did he write here? I have been working on this discography for a long time. It was all planned. I always try to achieve something that I haven't before musically. The only pressure for me is to be a better version. Oh my God, I'm blocking the text. Hold on, people. Hold on. Let me get rid of myself for a second. All right. The only pressure for me is to be better than the older version of myself. All right. Oh my God. And the album already leaked. Now I haven't listened to the leak. But apparently they've already started pressing vinyls and somebody got their hands on the vinyl. So I wouldn't be surprised if this whole album is already uploaded to the internet. But it looks like there's a few songs on there. Hold My Heart, Wake Me Up, Royalty. I see he has one song with Coldplay, which I am very interested to hear what that sounds like. I know he also has Playboi Carti on the album, but it doesn't look like he's credited, which makes sense. For some reason, whenever Playboi Carti's on the song, the song doesn't credit him. Like he was on that song, Off Vultures from Kanye's album, and he wasn't credited. He was on, you know, a few others. All right. So this right here is a clip from the Brazil concert. And this is the new song he premiered with Playboi Carti. And Playboi Carti even showed up for the concert. So let's go ahead and take a quick listen. Hopefully I don't get copyright strike. Ever since I was a kid, knew I was a shit. Try to keep on and come around, she wanna get hit. Today she done made me, cause I keep having my best side. Double up, bust on the watch, she know that I'm timeless. I put my son in. This beat sounds fire. I'm not even gonna lie. The beat alone already sounds fire. I'm red. I pull that gun off the hip. Talk is your 22 trip. I break a heart, cut my door so. Put on a shirt, get put on a blip. Feel like a stain, you fell into the lip. I had to tell her that ever since I was a cheat, no, I was a cheat. All right, I feel like I'm definitely going to get a copyright strike if I keep playing this. Or maybe not a copyright strike, but a copyright claim. But yeah, looks like... I feel like the fact that the vinyl is already pressed means that this album is going to release very, very soon. In fact, if I'm going to go ahead and throw my two cents and say that this album comes out this week, this Friday. That makes sense to me. Like, the album has already leaked. The vinyl's out there. So Abel is going to want to put this out as fast as possible. So I'm going to go ahead and say it's going to come out this week. That's my theory, at least. All right, let's go ahead and see what the chat is saying. All right, looks like we don't have any chatters. So we're going to go ahead and move on to our sixth story then. All right, I'm sure everyone has seen this by now, but Kendrick Lamar has been chosen to headline Super Bowl 2025. This is crazy news, crazy. So it looks like Super Bowl is happening in New Orleans next year, and looks like Jay-Z chose Kendrick to perform there, which is weird because I think people are upset that Lil Wayne wasn't chosen, and I have a theory about that. I think the reason Lil Wayne wasn't chosen is because Lil Wayne would 100% bring out Drake and Nicki Minaj. 100%. And something tells me that Jay-Z is on Kendrick's side of this beef. So instead of giving the slot to Lil Wayne, who would have brought out Drake, he gave it to Kendrick. Now, that's just my theory. I don't know if... I don't actually know the behind the scenes reasons for why Kendrick was chosen, but let's go ahead and cue this footage.
There you go. Give me one more. Ah! Come on. Two more. Just like that. You ready? Exactly. What the deal, everybody? My name Kendrick Lamar, and I'll be performing at Super Bowl 59. Will you be pulling up? I hope so. You know there's only one opportunity to win a championship. No round tools. Let's get it. Boom!
I feel like that was definitely a dig at Drake. There's only one opportunity to win a championship.
I won't want you to miss it. Meet me in New Orleans, February 9th, 2025. Wear your best dress too, even if you're watching from home. Let's go. Yay! That's what I'm talking about, man. Now we can get to it for real. Come on, you gotta make sure you catch him with the hands open like that. We running real routes, you gonna be messing up.
All right, so yeah, looks like I said, Kendrick was chosen. Even though I love the song, I love the diss song. What's the name of the big Kendrick song that he's dissing Drake in? All right, hold on, people. I feel like I have to look this up. Not like us. How could I forget that? Not like us. All right, so I feel like Not Like Us has become so overplayed now. Like, is Kendrick really gonna come out and perform that again? Like, obviously that would be bad for Drake. And you know what? Never mind. Like, it would be like a nuclear bomb for Drake having like the whole arena on live TV singing the A minor. Like, that's just gonna be redonkulous. It's gonna be redonkulous. But yeah, it looks like Lil Wayne's team has spoken up about Lil Wayne not being chosen. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. All right, so they posted a message on Instagram. Confused, disappointed, angry, but most of all, inspired. We'll never again be in a position or have the GOAT in a position where we are at the mercy of someone else's decision. We will make the decisions. All right, so yeah, it kind of sounds like Lil Wayne's team did not take the news very well. And I, for one, don't blame them. I feel like this is New Orleans. This is like Lil Wayne's home. Like, it would make more sense for Kendrick Lamar to headline the Super Bowl if it was in California. But it's New Orleans. Like, yeah, I would be feeling a type of way if I was Lil Wayne. I'm not going to lie. All right, let's go ahead and see what the chat is saying. All right, still no chat. Well, then we'll go ahead and move on to our final story of the night. All right, I'm excited to talk about this one because this story involves me personally. Cudi Bino, yours truly, went to the New World Tour over the week. That's right. I saw Childish Gambino live on his New World Tour. And I am in awe. There are no words to describe how amazing this performance was. I've seen Gambino live. I seen him live for his camp tour. I saw him live twice for his camp tour. I saw him live for his This Is America tour. I saw him live for his Final Pharaohs. And so this would be the fifth time. This is the fifth time I've seen Gambino. This is the best he's ever been. This is the best show I've ever seen him put on. Like, I have no words. Let's go ahead and check this out. Okay, spoilers. If you haven't seen this man on tour and you're planning on seeing him, click off this video because we are about to spoil this set list. This was an amazing set list. All right, let's move it a little bit further. All right, guys, this man came out to Hearts Were Meant to Fly, which is the first track off the album. So I was actually expecting that. His second song, Survive, just an amazing song. It's like the perfect appetizer to what was to come. Then he started with The Worst Guys, which is the guitar on this song live. It's just dreamy. His production he had on this tour, I'm gonna play a few clips, but the production, the videos don't do it justice. People, if you have not seen this man on tour, buy tickets now. This is the final Childish Gambino tour, allegedly. You don't want to miss it. So yeah, he went from The Worst Guys, goes to Talk My Shit, then Got to Be, which is just crazy live. Then he did like a shortened version of In the Night, and then went straight into Yoshinoya, like the second half. And it was at this point of the concert that I realized that this wasn't a concert. This was a giant Childish Gambino party. This concert is a celebration of Childish Gambino. Like, I knew exactly what Donald was going for when we got to this point. It was nothing but high energy banger after banger. After Yoshinoya, he went to To Be Hunted. He then did Witchy. He then did Earn. He did Earn. And after that, he did Crawl, which was my... By the way, I went into this show not knowing what the set list was. I purposely avoided spoiling myself with this set list. So the only songs I knew for sure he was performing were songs that he was teasing on his Instagram. So like Lithonia, Hearts Were Meant to Fly. I knew he was going to perform Survive. But other than that, I had no idea, people, what I was in for. When he performed Craw, this was just a big moment for me because I missed the Bacusta Internet Tour. I never saw it. So I never got to see this song live in person. So hearing Craw live was just like a... It made up for the fact that I missed the Bacusta Internet Tour. After Craw, he went into Cruisin'. Then he went into Feels Like Summer. And I was shocked that he performed Feels Like Summer instead of Summertime Magic. But I'm not complaining. This song hit live. He then went into Human Sacrifice, which I've heard this song live a few times now, but still, it's just, he said it himself. This song was meant to be performed live. Let's scroll down. All right. Then he performed A Place Where Love Goes, which is just, the lasers on this song is crazy. Then he performed what may be his best song he's ever made, No Excuses. I was dying to hear this song live. I cannot express to you how much I love this song. And when he started performing this song, he literally on the microphone says, "All right, guys, this is the intermission. If you want to take a bathroom break or grab a beer, now's the time to do it." I was mad. I was mad that he chose my favorite song to make the intermission song. But it's whatever. Like, the song itself was just amazing. He also said that you might want to go grab a beer now because things are about to get crazy. And that got me so excited for the second half of this show, especially considering that he like burned through all the Bando Stone songs in the first half. So I already knew we were about to get the greatest hits, basically. After No Excuses, he went into Me and Your Mama, which is like a top tier Gambino song. After that, he went to Do You Like, and this, I was surprised to hear him perform this song because this is such an old song. This is off Cul-de-Sac, one of his early mixtapes. So this was for the hardcore Gambino fans. Then he went into This Is America, which is just his most popular song by far. Then he went into Sweatpants, Sober. Sober, that crazy drop at the end, just the light show and everything was just perfect. Then he went into Camp Songs. I was so shocked and surprised and happy to hear him performing Camp Songs because he has not performed these songs in like 10 years. He did not touch Camp on the This Is America tour, his last tour. So he goes from Less to Heartbeat to Bonfire to Freaks and Geeks. And I told my friends before the show started that if he performs Freaks and Geeks, I would cry. It did not disappoint. Freaks and Geeks. And then he gave us the choice of Telegraph Ave or Shadows. And obviously the fans are going to pick Telegraph Ave, like, over Shadows. Even though I love Shadows, but Telegraph Ave is another song because I missed the BTI tour. This was another song I never got to see live. So it was just great to hear that live. After that, he went into 3005. And then he ended the show on Redbone. And then that wasn't actually the final song. He came back out for an encore to perform Lithonia. And yeah, it was about 30 songs. Just a perfect set list. I have to admit, like when I saw him for the This Is America tour, I was a little disappointed because it was only like 18 songs and it was mostly Awaken My Love songs. So he didn't perform a lot of his older songs. He didn't perform Freaks and Geeks or Telegraph Ave or Bonfire or Do You Like or any of these older songs. So it was just so nice so nice to hear these songs live. But yeah, let's go ahead and play some of the footage I stole from Instagram. I sadly had nosebleed seats, so my footage is not that great, or it doesn't do it justice. And like I said, even this video doesn't do it justice. But look at the freaking production, man. The stage. Like this Donald calls this the light binder. I don't even know how to describe it. It was like these, I would say like, it was almost like rope, like neon ropes that were just, I don't even know how to describe it. Just look at it. Look at the stage. This was exactly what I wanted from Gambino. This Is America tour was more of him like doing like a very serious performance, whereas I feel like this the theme of the night was just fun. Just have fun. Like, we're going to have a giant party and Gambino's the host. Like, I cannot describe how amazing this concert was. I literally thought I would never hear Bonfire live again. Like, for some reason, Donald has been staying away from performing his older hits. And I feel like maybe it's, he finds them a little corny now or cringe or whatever. But I am so happy that he's like, I don't know the word, he's like, you know, embracing the cringe. That's the best way to put it. He's embracing the cringe. He's like embracing his older material. Like I said, this was just a celebration. All right, so yeah, that was the concert. Like I said, I have no words. It was just an amazing experience. Probably the best concert I've been to. And keep in mind, the last time I saw Gambino, I was like 15 feet away from him because I saw him at Pharoah's and there was just a few hundred people there. This concert, even though I was in the third section of the arena, like the nosebleeds, it was still the best show I've ever seen. Like, people, please, even if you get cheap seats, it's worth it. Trust me. I don't think I'll ever see a concert like that again. And that makes me sad. I feel like I will never connect with a concert like I did that concert. All right, let's see what the chat is saying. All right, it looks like there's nobody in the chat. All right, well, that's the show, people. I don't think I'll be live Wednesday, but maybe I will if I decide to. I think the best thing going forward is I'm going to just do one live stream a week. So live streams on Sundays only. And if I do Wednesday live streams, they'll be very sporadic. So check your notifications to see if I do a Wednesday live stream. But expect to see me here same time, same place, Sunday night. So with that out of the way, let's go ahead and cue the credits.